Hey, what's up guys, Pablo Munoz here. Welcome back to another video tutorial. Today I'm going to show you how I achieve this comic style render, this type of quality directly from ZBrush using a custom material that I built for this type of render, so this type of style. So this image that you can see here on the screen is one of my recent works and is done 100% in ZBrush. And just a little disclaimer to show you what is not part of ZBrush. All that sort of like textures that you see here, that's kind of like a paper texture that I overlaid on top, but I just did that in Photoshop. The rest is 100% ZBrush. And also the background is kind of like painted after because I was focusing on just the character. But I'm going to show you how I put this together, and I'm going to share with you as well the resources so you can basically do the same thing. So let's go ahead and jump straight into ZBrush. And here is the model, right? As you can see, it's all in 3D, all in ZBrush. All of those kind of like tiny details, all the kind of like the hatched effects and all of that, that is sculpted directly in ZBrush so that you can basically see it with the comic material. All right, so the comic material is this one right here that I have on my UI already. It's called the Pablander Super Comic 2022, just for a lack of a better name. And I just put the year 2022 because this is actually an updated version of the comic style render material that I shared a couple of years ago. And it's just a new version that works a lot better with polypaint and a few other tweaks that I'm going to show you. So basically, if I, with this mesh, if I go ahead and just click on this material and I switch back to it, it's basically what you can see on the render, right? And the great thing about this is that obviously we're taking advantage of the 3D-ness of the object. And then we can basically, yeah, rotate the camera around, and from every angle is going to look, I think, pretty cool in terms of the comic style. Now you can see that, let's say if I select the visor, yeah, this, or maybe the head of this weird seahorse type of thing, this is a little bit clearer, or it's, you know, wider than the other bits and pieces. That is just a thing that ZBrush uses to help you identify which is the selected subtool. So when I hold the Alt key and click, that basically selects the active subtool, but this is kind of like the color. Now, if I go ahead and enable polypaint, I'm just going to hold shift and click on this polypaint. This is a quick polypaint that I did as a reference for that image. And let's just go back to this one. Let's say you want a blue background like this. I'm just going to go to the color and let's select something roughly the same color as what I have in the final illustration. And I'm just going to click on, oops, let's go back to document. I'm going to click on this back once, and ZBrush is going to grab whatever color I had selected. So as you can see, it's pretty similar. And yeah, so this is the color that I use, or the poly paint that I use as reference. And then obviously I polished it because, as you can see, it's pretty rough, the transition. So I just spent a bit more time, but I thought I'd just give you a reference of how this one works. All right, so basically that's about it. there's no more to it. Like if you stop this tutorial at this point, you can basically download that material and apply it to your model, and it should look pretty decent. Now, the cool thing about the material, like I said, is that it works with polypaint, meaning that if I go ahead and do a screenshot, I'm just gonna do a screenshot and go here to Photoshop, and let's go ahead and just paste it in there. Just a screenshot. There we go. And let's switch to the flat mode, the one that only shows you the polypaint, so it's a shadeless version. Let's do the same thing, just another screenshot. And this is purely to show you the difference. I'm going to basically cut there. And if I go closer, you see that the polypaint, the quality, like the vibrance of the color and everything else, it is maintained. And that is the main update to this shader. Before, it was kind of like overexposed, and it was mainly a shader to get the outlines from the model. But now it works with polypaint, so you can basically create your entire graphic novel from ZBrush. All right, so let's switch back to preview. And yeah, this is kind of like the example that I wanted to show you. Like I said, all of these details that you see here, those are directly sculpted in. So if I select, let's say, this top of the seahorse, I'm going to use a custom brush like the HR Geiger cutter. So this is part of my Geiger and Beksinski pack, if you're interested, but you can also use something like the damn standard brush. And with this material already enabled, what I'll do is start doing this, right? So you can just literally paint in the details, and as you rotate around, because these are literally sculpted into the mesh, they'll stay with whatever angle you choose. So that's how I achieve all those additional details all around the model that I think look pretty cool and sort of like help with the you know, the quality of this comic style render. That is a particular style that I really enjoy, and you know, it's something that I spend time doing manually, but you can automate it with some other filters at render time. But anyway, so that's the idea. Now I'm going to show you how easy it is to set it up and kind of like breaking down a bit that material. So I'm going to switch to something else. Right, so this is kind of like a miniature hard surface character that we've been working on the ZBrush Live, in case you want to, you know, have a look at how this is created. And I also use it in my latest tutorial where I show you some of the PBR workflow just to render and blend materials. So this guy here is basically to give you an example of what you can do once you download the comic material. So you download the comic material, this one right here, you load it into ZBrush. The way that you load materials is basically going to material, load, and just select the Blender Super Comic 2022. And with whatever mesh you have, you can just click on it and it automatically gives you a pretty decent result. Let's go ahead and do a quick render just to get all the, you know, the white color in all the areas like that. And if you want, we can just also click on, I have this in my UI, but it's the same thing that I just showed you in the document. Back, I'm going to select a white color. So it looks nice, like the ink version or the outlines. And that's pretty much it. There's nothing else that you need to do. Of course, you can tweak the material quite a bit, but that's what that's kind of like the advanced next step that I'm going to show you. So let's go ahead and do that. By the way, if you want to get rid of this gray kind of like dimming of the subtools, you can go to Preference, then Edit. And if you scroll down, this inactive subtool dimming is set to 0.75. Just set it to 1, and that way there's going to be no dimming. It's kind of like an opacity. Or if you want to make it a bit more prominent, the same way, you just set it to something less, and that way you see when you switch between subtools which one is the one. But yeah, so for this particular case, I'm going to set it to 1 so that everything is the same. And if you want to see which one you have selected, you either have a look at the subtool or press the S key, which in my case I have mapped to the solo mode, so I can just isolate them easily. All right, so if I get closer here, you'll see sometimes with this matcap, things get a little bit noisy, but that is depending on the model itself, right? So you don't have to create something super, you know, highly detailed in terms of the model, because the more details you have, the more surface, high frequency details you have, the more noisy the material is going to make the render look. So even if I go to the lowest subdivision level, just to show you, let's go all low. Right, so we have pretty faceted polygons, and I switch to the material. This looks already pretty decent. Of course, you have this jagged line, but you can, you know, you can fix that by going bit by bit to the highest subdivision level. So I just wanted to mention that you don't have to have like a super detailed mesh. All right, so the reason I want to show you this other character, let's go ahead and put the material on the right-hand side or the left-hand side here. So this is the material. It's made out of four kind of like shaders. And if I turn them on and off by clicking on this circle, you'll see what the material does. So the main one, or the first one, is this kind of like very subtle diffuse material that has this shadow. And this shadow is based on the lighting in ZBrush. So you can move the lighting around. So let's go to the lighting. Let's put that on the right-hand side. And you can just move that lighting and you see that first shader, it totally reacts to the light. So if you like this more subtle comic style with no additional outlines, you can totally just use that and move the lighting around, change how dramatic the shadow is. You can also turn on the last one just to get some nice outlines. And that's pretty much it, really. The last one, the S4, is ultimately just a refinement of the outline. So if you turn that on, this is what you get. And you still have, you know, you can make it react to the light and create something pretty cool looking, right? Now, the second one is the one that gives you all these intricate details, right? And this is the one that you can tweak depending on how much detail you have in your model. So if you click on S2, you have this cavity transition and the cavity detection, right? The cavity detection is set to 1. You can change that. But the one that deals with these details is the transition. So you can just change that and you see how much is changing, maybe from the distance. Or you can switch it around, and instead of targeting the cavity, it's going to target the inverted kind of like edges. So you can play around with this and get like some interesting looking results. So if you want to just maintain kind of like the comic style, what I would recommend is just to change the cavity transition and then play with the detection so that it's kind of like an opacity of how much ZBrush is detecting those cavities. So that way I just, you know, achieve like a more subtle result just by changing the cavity detection and the transition. All right, so that's basically the S2. That's what it does. The S3 gives you some fake shadows, but it really kind of like enhances the comic look. So what that means is that the S3 is actually a matcap. It's the only shader of this material that is actually a matcap. And for those of you who don't know, a matcap is just a material capture. So it uses an image, this one right here. And you can see it's an image that already has those shadows applied to it. Now, the cool thing about this one, let's turn off the details so you can clearly see. By the way, if you turn off the first one, nothing will happen. It will just be a silhouette. So make sure that the at least S1 is enabled. Now, the S3, like I said, you can tweak it, right? So you can change that image for something else. And that image is the one that is giving you those shadows. Now, what's cool about this combination of matcap and a standard shader in ZBrush is that because the matcap has already the lighting embedded into it, if I change the lighting, that's not going to change. So you see in my thumbnail here on the top right, the shadow on the left, that essentially is the one that ZBrush is using to produce the cast shadows from the light, but the other one stays in there. So you can create like some weird looking matcaps or materials and renders, right? So this is a combination of the standard shader in ZBrush that uses the light position to create those shadows and the matcap that has that shadow already embedded in an image. Now, the other cool thing about this matcap is that you can totally change the depth of this shadow. So if you go to the depth, it's set to 0.6 or 0.5999, but you change that, you can change the depth A and depth B. And that is kind of like creating an inflate or a pinch to that image. So let me just show you what I mean. So I set this to 0.5 and 0.5, right? So now that image is kind of like pinched into the center. So it creates like a pretty strong shadow. And you can do the same thing, but the other way around. So let's go for 0.2 and 0.2. So now it is kind of like pushed towards the edges. So you can play around with the depth, right? So let's go for 0.4 and 0.4. That's probably a little bit more decent. And the other cool thing is that because you have the depth A and B, meaning two different colors, you can do like a second shader, or not a shader, but a kind of like a cell shading with two colors. So you can set this to 0.9 and this one let's go 0.4. So you see that it's like a nice gray gradient. So just by changing the depth A and depth B so that they're not in the same value, you get this effect. And this is still working on its own. You can still change the lighting. For the most part, I would match the lighting with this matcap. But anyway, it's there in case you wanted to, right? So another cool thing is with the final shader, let's go ahead and enable the details, right? And the final shader, S4, is the one that gives you that line, that outline that I mentioned before. So this one, I wouldn't recommend changing it too much, but in case you want to do a thicker outline, this is also a matcap. Sorry, I mentioned that the only matcap was this. This is actually a matcap as well. So S4 is also based on this image that has the outline, and you can change that. So by default, it's set to 0.5, but if you set it to let's go for 0.1, or actually let's go for 1 and 1, right? So I just basically changed the depth of that image, and now you have a thicker outline, right? In case you want to have that, right? A thicker outline. If you want something a bit more subtle, leave it at 0.5 or even 0.2, and you see it's pretty subtle. It's barely visible, so let's set it to the default one. I don't usually change this one. I think this is just a nice addition to wrap up this series of shaders, right? Okay, so that is essentially what this material is, like how it is being built. And if I go ahead and enable polypaint for this guy, and maybe let's change the background a little bit, you'll see that everything works nice with the colors. So I'm going to turn this into the flat mode. So this is the polypaint that I did for this version of this character as a comic. And if I click on the preview, it is using, it's kind of like overlaying all those details and the outline of the material on top of the color. But that's pretty much it. Hopefully you have found this reference video useful on how to use the comic shader. I'm going to make sure I put the link in the description so you can download this material, load it into ZBrush. You need the latest version of ZBrush, or at the time of this recording, 2022.0.5, so that you can load this material with no issues. All right, so I'm going to leave this video here. Please let me know how you go, and I would love to see what you make with this comic material. Cheers.